OJ Simpson, who was shockingly acquitted in that trial of the century, has died of cancer at the age of 76. The football star turned Hollywood actor was controversially cleared of killing his ex-wife, Nicole Brown, and her friend in a verdict which divided America.
Let's go live to US correspondent Tim Lester. Tim, the trial was watched by 150 million people worldwide.
Shervo, the courts here in California around America had not seen anything like it. 8 months of evidence, an extraordinary case that captured the imagination not just of the country, but many around the world. Everyone had to have an opinion on whether OJ Simpson was a hero hard done by or a killer. And frankly, today, it's still an issue undecided.
He was an American hero on so many levels. OJ Simpson, football legend, inducted into the Hall of Fame after retiring, Hollywood called.
Nobody does it better.
TV and movies.
Norbert!
How you, buddy? Hey! Doc says I should be on my bean and as good as new in a week.
In 1985, he married Nicole Brown. The glamorous couple had two children, divorcing 7 years later following allegations of domestic violence. In 1994, Nicole Brown and her friend Ron Goldman were found dead at her Los Angeles home.
They may be driving a white or light-coloured Ford Bronco.
Simpson was charged with their murders, but failed to turn himself in and was declared a fugitive, leading police on a low-speed two-hour chase across LA before eventually surrendering, watched live by 95 million people. The trial of the century followed, televised and captivating America. Crucial evidence, blood-stained gloves found at the scene. In one of the trial's most memorable moments, prosecutors asked Simpson to wear the gloves. He struggled to put them on, the blunder leading to a now famous closing statement from Simpson's lawyer.
If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
It took the jury just 4 hours to reach a verdict.
We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, not guilty.
3 years later, OJ was found liable for Nicole and Ron's deaths in a civil suit brought by the victims' families. A dramatic fall from grace. OJ was back in court multiple times over the next several years for traffic violations, even pirating cable TV. But it was a Las Vegas robbery in 2008 that ultimately sent him to prison. He served 9 years before being released in 2017. In a statement, Simpson's family revealed that he died of cancer, surrounded by his children and grandchildren. OJ Simpson was 76.
At the time, reporter Tony Coghlan was in the US covering the story for 7 News.
It's a hung jury, as most legal experts predict. There are plans to try Simpson all over again. In Los Angeles, Tony Coghlan, 11 a.m.
And Tony joins us now. Good morning to you. Tell us what your reaction was to this news.
Good morning, Nat. I was just looking at, I looked a lot younger back then. That was my first reaction. But yes, it's been a big day. It's almost as big as when the verdict came down. So much interest in America on OJ dying at the age of 76 from cancer. It's been a story that's captivated America for over 30 years, since the infamous slow-speed chase to the verdict, to the civil case, to him getting arrested for armed robbery. It's the story that just has kept us really fascinated for so long.
Yeah, look, I was there too in an American newsroom as a very junior covering this, and it was amazing to watch, wasn't it, when everything stopped. And I think, what, more than 90 million people watched this that we're seeing on the screen this morning. For those who may not have heard it, his friend Al Cowlings took the wheel of that car and drove him, and we didn't know what was going to happen next, did we?
It was totally riveting. If you may remember, it was the night of the NBA basketball finals. So people were tuned in for that. And all of a sudden, CNN broke away and you had this split screen of the slow speed chase on one side and the basketball on the other. And in the end, the slow speed chase took over. That's what everyone wanted to watch. And for 2 hours, no one was sure if OJ was going to kill himself, if the cops were going to pull him over and there'd be a gun battle. And the slow speed chase just changed the way American news covered big stories like that. And again, as you say, like 90, 95 million people glued to their screens, seeing this American idol, an American hero, being pursued by police on a double murder charge.
Yeah, I think they said Al Cowlings, his mate who was driving, had called the police and said, back off, I can sort of sort this out. And that's why the cops, you can see the cop cars, can't you, behind that car. It was absolutely gripping. And as Australians, I think you were probably the same. I don't think we'd really seen live rolling coverage much like this before.
No, it was a game changer. And to think that here is this guy who is, if you're going to put it in Australian context, imagine Greg Norman, not that he ever would, but would be accused of a murder, and how Australia would be just glued to the screen wanting to know what's going to happen to Greg Norman. OJ Simpson was that big, probably bigger. He was not only a sports hero, but he was a sports commentator. He was in movies. He was on TV commercials. He was so famous. And then you had the three essential ingredients. You had celebrity, you had money, and you had murder. So a perfect national soap opera was about to begin.
And then, of course, the trial. We're seeing those shots on our screens where he's trying on a glove. Explain to us the significance of that.
Well, that was, again, the turning point in the trial. It was OJ Simpson testifying, but without testifying. He tried on gloves with latex gloves, so they were never going to fit. And then Johnny Cochran, that most memorable quote, "If it don't fit, you must acquit," echoed in that courtroom, and the jurors ultimately, in a very short space of time, thought there was enough reasonable doubt to get OJ off this double murder charge.
Yeah, it was an incredible point in time. 150 million people watched that verdict. The jury went out, I think, for a few hours and came back. And you're right, they did acquit. Thank you very much, Tony. We very much appreciate your time this morning explaining how you lived through that all those years ago.
In prison, high-profile lawyer Gloria Allred represented Nicole Brown's family during the trial of the century, and she joins us now from LA. Good morning to you. Well, firstly, what was your reaction to the news of OJ's passing?
Well, I, of course, my heart goes out to the children who are now adults, but they were very young when Mr. Simpson, their father, killed their mother, Nicole, and left her almost decapitated on the front step of their condominium where their young children were sleeping inside and could have come out any moment looking for mommy and discovered her in a pool of blood. Thank God they didn't come out. They would have been extra traumatized for the rest of their life if they had seen their mother in that situation. But I'm also, you know, just so sad and heartbroken for the brave family of Nicole Brown Simpson. The sisters, Denise and Dominique and Tanya, and of course, their father and mother, who were Judith and Lou, who are no longer with us. But in any event, we should remember that even 5 years before the 1994 killing of Nicole by Mr. Simpson, he was victimizing her. He beat her. He gave her a black eye. We've seen a photo of that. She was forced to leave the house, and she was terrified and hid in the bushes. Ultimately, Mr. Simpson was charged with spousal battery. He pled no contest, which means that he admitted it. And guess what? The judge didn't even sentence him to one day in jail for what he did to Nicole. So that simply empowered him, perhaps emboldened him. And we see what happened after that.
Exactly.
And the jury was right in the civil case to find that he was responsible. He testified in the civil case. He didn't in the criminal case. Obviously, they didn't believe him, and that's why they found him responsible.
Yeah, the world basically stood still, didn't it, 30 years ago. What was it like being at the center of this, Gloria?
Well, you know, my job was to help be the voice of Nicole, the victim, who, of course, lost her voice when she was killed by Mr. Simpson, and, you know, to shine a light on domestic violence. The narrative of the defense was that somehow this was racial, that Mr. Simpson was being prosecuted because he was a successful, famous, wealthy African-American man. That, of course, was nonsense. he was being prosecuted because he had killed his wife or soon-to-be ex-wife. And there was a mountain of evidence, that was a term that was being used, against him, including his blood evidence all over the crime scene. But it turned out that that was a very strong card to play. Yeah. Johnny Cochran, who was one of the famous attorneys representing Mr. Simpson, you know, said that, you know, keep your eyes on the prize, which is a famous civil rights saying, you know, for the advancement of African Americans. And I have done many cases where representing victims of racial injustice and discrimination. But this was not one of those cases. This was a violence against women case, and we have to remember that. And the system is just ineffective still 30 years later in helping to protect the rights of victims of violence, particularly by celebrity men who have so much power and much money.
And that's part of the issue, isn't it? Domestic violence all over the world, including here in Australia as well, is still a problem. Gloria, just very quickly, how should the world remember O.J. Simpson now?
As a convicted felon, as a person who killed two people, Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman, and changed and transformed the lives of their families and his children, all for the worse. That's his legacy, not as a famous football star, but as someone who should have been ashamed to walk this earth.
Gloria,
the only good thing about his death is perhaps the victims can now rest in peace.
Yeah, maybe Gloria. Some closure for the victims' families. Gloria, thank you so much for your time. For more, US broadcaster Cooper Lawrence joins us now. Well, take us through who OJ was before his fall from grace.
Good morning, Nat and Shervo. You know, before his fall from grace, he was a huge star. He was one of those football guys that everybody loved. If you didn't know anything about football, you knew who O.J. Simpson was. He played for a lot of the big teams, the Buffalo Bills. He's from San Francisco. So he really had that very likable. People loved him, and so did sponsors. He had all kinds of sponsorships, and when he started doing movies, people loved him even more because they got to see his personality. They got to see he was more than just the guy on the field. So for a lot of little boys who grew up in the late 80s, he was an icon to them. They had his poster on their wall. So he was an important person for them sports-wise.
Yeah, and then suddenly he's charged with murder, goes to trial, gets off in spectacular fashion. Tell us what the Kardashian connection is here.
Robert Kardashian was one of O.J. Simpson's lawyers. Now, just to give you a little perspective, Robert Kardashian was more famous than Kim at the time. I mean, she was a child. And Robert Kardashian was one of these lawyers who took on people that you were sure they were guilty. They were never going to win. He defended the indefendable. That was his thing. And he was married to Kris Jenner until 1991. So by the time the O.J. Simpson trial came around, they were already divorced. And I don't know if you guys realize, but Kris Jenner and Nicole Brown Simpson, OJ's wife that he allegedly, I guess I can't say killed because he was acquitted, but, you know, the people still think that he murdered, they were best friends. But Robert Kardashian was also best friends with OJ Simpson. And this really divided the family. Even though they were already divorced by now for 3 years, the kids were divided. Kim Kardashian has said in interviews that she thought her father can do no wrong, so she assumed, well, his friend couldn't be guilty, otherwise why would he defend him? And she was the outlier of her family. Her entire family was like, what are you talking about? Of course he did it. And Kim said no. If daddy said no, then we have to believe him. So it really divided the family. And then as the years went on, as Kim got older, she has said that she regrets that decision and that she doesn't like to talk about it now, but it's one of those things that she just feels she didn't want to stand by her father, even though she did.
Wow. So, Coops, high-profile case, high-profile life, wasn't it? What about the high-profile reaction this morning?
A lot of celebrities are staying away from this because most celebrities, remember, Kris Jenner, very powerful in Hollywood, she basically said he is persona non grata, and everybody followed along. So he was shunned. By 1994, nobody would talk to him. He moved to Florida. He got the heck out of California for that reason. So, you know, Caitlyn Jenner, who was married to Kris Jenner, has tweeted that, you know, good riddance, which is a big deal because she spoke out and she knew him. So if she's saying good riddance, it kind of gives people who didn't like him and who think that he did murder his wife and Ron Goldman, it kind of gives them a little bit of like, maybe he knows something, maybe they know something, maybe she knows something.
Yeah, and of course then the domestic violence allegations 30 years ago, before the words domestic violence or DV were sort of even in the vernacular. That's another whole story, isn't it? Cooper, we thank you very much for explaining a lot
this morning. Thank you.